the explosion really of CTV and really all online video is just continuously growing. Obviously a big portion of that is COVID and moving us to home. So we're streaming on different services, new services are being offered. So it's really where the dollars are going because it's where the eyes are going. And you have a very unique structure from traditional TV now to CTV because you have those who may be in an older age bracket who prefer watching live, but then you also have a younger age group who wants to cut cords. They want to get online. They want to watch what they want to watch and when they want to watch it. They don't want to deal with paying a premium service. They prefer to see content that's custom created for them. And with healthcare, what that changes for us is we have an opportunity to reach more people and help them, whether they're the caregiver or the actual patient. And so it's really important for us to allocate dollars in our spend to get into CTV so that we can ensure that we're not missing a portion of the population. And now I say that, but we also have restrictions because it is healthcare and pharmaceutical and who we can advertise to. So for us, we have to be very careful on where we're actually putting our messages out. So if, you know, we can't advertise to kids under a certain age, we have to be very cognizant of some of the new platforms that exist more in the social media or short form video streaming services. And from a viewability and fraud perspective, you know, it's very important for us with viewability to make sure that our message is seen by the people who need help. And again, that could be the caregiver, that could be the actual patient. So if we're not getting our message across to the right person at the right time, where they're actually seeing the message, then we're not going to help somebody further down the funnel when they need education on what's happening to their family member or friend. Or we're not actually turning a patient and saying, this is an opportunity to help you live a better life. We do need to rely on verification partners. Double Verify is in that mix. You know, obviously there's other vendors out there in the space, but in order for us as an agency to work well with the advertisers, we need a verification partner such as Double Verify who can sit down with us and the suppliers to say, you know, this isn't viewable. We have to do a better job or there is fraud. And obviously CTV has a lot of fraud right now because that's where the dollars are going. And it's a joint effort. It's not one segment or another. We all have to work together to ensure we're putting quality control measures in place. That could be Omni tags that Double Verify has. For suppliers, it's ensuring that their inventory is clean from fraud. And that's where, again, Double Verify can come into play because they can put tags in place so that when our messages do serve to consumers, we're making sure that it's truly a human. You know, we don't want to run against a bot. We want to know that it's an actual person. You know, I want to see a message that is pertinent to me, but I also want to know that I'm seeing the message. If I'm just getting a portion of an ad served, I don't really know what that is, and it may not even engage my interest to go further. And so the more we can do to work together, because again, this is a collective effort. This isn't one segment or another who this falls to, but really rely on services that verification partners offer to help move the needle forward. But you know, it's applying pressure sometimes to the suppliers to say, if there's fraud on your site, you know, if you don't have that with desktop or traditional other digital aspects of ad serving, you know, maybe we need to look at what's happening with CTV. Just because the dollars are going there doesn't mean that we need to let fraudsters get in. And so it's really saying if your traditional digital methods are clean, then we can trust that your CTV inventory is as well.
And finally, a lot of talk about blacklists and whitelists and COVID, and it's a complicated issue. Maybe you could sort of speak to some of the concerns, directions from pharmaceutical clients. You know, obviously some of them are involved with treating COVID or want to be associated, others don't. Broadly, how does that work?
So it's actually a mixed bag. We have some clients that really just don't want to run against as much COVID content as possible, because if you look back when this started, more specifically for the US, in March and April, we didn't know what was going to happen 6 months from now. And here we are, still work from home, waiting on a vaccine or a cure, you know, whichever comes first. So this is such an evolving disease that, or virus, I should say, maybe, that it evolves how our clients are responding as well. You know, you don't want to get too far down the funnel of advertising with COVID messaging if, one, you weren't going to enter that game originally. And then two, if you are entering that game, you don't want to give false hope because, you know, again, we're 6 months, 7 months in and not much has changed. So you have to really be careful. And our guidance is, it's somewhat of a value statement of where you fall, but it's very much, are you confident in your product coming to market? And if you're not, or if you're not entirely sure if that's the right messaging for you to run around, because there are a lot of negative words associated with COVID, and, you know, masks have become a hot topic. So you have to be very careful about like where your brand stands from a value standpoint, even if you're a company that's there to help everyone in the long run.